And let's turn to Romans chapter 11. We're in class number 48. I think I had brown hair when I started teaching Romans. I'm not sure. Lord. In fact, I know I did when I first started teaching Romans. Romans chapter 11. I want to just start this class with this explanation I've given a couple of times of grace. And just to reiterate, because we're going to be getting into things that will help us to see this new definition in its proper light. But Romans 11, verse 5 and 6. Even so, then, at this present time also there is a remnant according to the election of grace. For if by grace, then it is no more works, otherwise grace is no more grace. But if it be of works, then it is no more grace, otherwise work is no more work. All right, so let me explain that in theological terms. If you be dead, then you dead. And if you alive and doing stuff for God, stop it because you dead. And that's the grace of God. Okay? All right? And we'll see that as we get down a little further in specific scriptures that are really, really magnifying that. All right, so let me read a little bit here. This subtitle is called Grace Founded on Selfless Giving. Initial faith causes us to believe in the cross of Christ as our means of redemption, and all of us should be very familiar with that, initial faith. And it is belief in the cross of Christ, and it is in relationship to us in terms of redemption. Right there at the beginning of exercising faith are we introduced to the concept of grace. The very word grace is a reference to life out of death, or an example of God's cross method. Okay, we're going to be using that little two-word phrase, whatever, a lot now in this section that we're getting into, because we're going to be awakened to the fact that our faith doesn't just rest in the cross that happened 2,000 years ago. Our faith rests in the operation of God, the way God operates. Ah, see, no, not just the operation of God at the cross then at that moment, but we want to begin, and we're making a little bit of a turn here, because we want to go away from this Romans series with a clear understanding of where faith is supposed to be taking us and where we're supposed to end up, which I think we all realize because it's quoted so many times in the New Testament. The just shall live by faith. If you're justified, but you can't live by, I guess you can say, I live by the faith that Jesus died and I'm saved, so I live by that every day. But in the context of those scriptures, that's not what it's talking about. All right, so I said the very word grace is a reference to life out of death, or an example of God's cross method. Because life out of death, as we discovered, really isn't just tied to death bringing forth life, but to suffering, moving into reigning, and on and on and on, and to losing, ending up gaining, These concepts that I just said, and they're all from different places in the scriptures, are identifying what we've been calling life out of death, and what I'm throwing in a new term for you, God's cross method. God's cross method. Anytime you see the word grace, you should think selfless giving, because we do not deserve it, but he selfishly gives it anyway. Okay. It is always by grace through faith. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ is exampled and created by his self-giving on the cross. The cross is the grace or the graciousness of God. But all the things that come from that are benefits of someone, and that's capitalized in my notes, of someone being selfless. It is not, grace is not just some magical element that floats around in heaven and he sort of shoots it down to us when we get in trouble or when we need help. It all proceeds and emanates from something selflessly done, given, poured out. I can't give you all the words. Yes. Right. 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 Well, and maybe I can dig into it a little more when I finish this paragraph, but the cross bought and brought the benefits, but through a certain spirit in which Jesus gave of himself. Whatever things he bought and brought, whatever benefits that we get from that, came because he gave himself. Okay, now let's apply that to life out of death. If you have life, if you gained life from Jesus, you got that because he died. And he died, didn't deserve that death. It wasn't just God sitting on the throne and going, I think I'll save some people. You're saved, here's some grace, and you're saved, and here's some grace, and you're saved, here's some grace. It wasn't like that at all. The grace of it always comes because of an act of selfless giving, and in this case, the act of selfless giving of the Lord at the cross. Imagine someone getting in trouble here in the Bible school, and one of our teachers steps up and they take the blame for it, and they say, I did it, and you know, I'll be kicked out of the school as a teacher, and da-da-da-da, and all this kind of stuff. And that person continues to, the other person gets grace to continue. It wasn't just, oh, continue, we'll just give you grace. In that example, someone suffered and someone gained. This is life out of death. This is God's cross method. This is the grace of God and how it operates. Okay. So, as Mallory was pointing out, we sort of see God up on a throne, and he's got a bunch of special attributes that we don't have. He's got grace, and he's got mercy, and he's got love, and he's got this and that. And so we see him giving us those things, but there's no way that can happen unless somebody else suffered in that place. Or it's not coming to you. There is no grace without somebody giving themselves. And when I say that, in the example I gave of some teacher stepping in, that was Jesus in that teacher. Do you understand? It wasn't just them going, and I'll explain why I'm using the term cross method here in a minute. I'm trying to break through barriers. I'm trying to break through misconceptions that hold us at bay from the heart of the Lord and hold us back from realizing that all that we get came from that side that's pouring out blood and water. All that we get came from all that, that came from, you know, his death and his selfless giving and his, you know, so he could say, Father, forgive them. But he'd already, you know, or was in the process of paying for it. And if it was really just that easy by saying, Father, forgive them, why come down here and go through all that hell? Just stay up there and go, well, I see, I think I'm going to forgive them, or I'm gonna forgive those three, or I'm going to forgive, you know what I mean? But if he forgave those three, then you're not God. You have to be benevolent to all, but it's not benevolence. It is the true translation or meaning of charity, love, true love, where there was a death so that he can say, he can look at his son. Again, you know what I want to do? I think, because I keep going to this point, I want to take that picture I painted recently and just slap it up there. And the whole time I'm teaching, just go, that's what I'm talking about. That, right there. There you see it. There, you know, Nisi asked me about, you know, have I drawn any new pictures or painted, or we were talking about it because Abigail draws and stuff. And so I showed her that one, and she said, yeah, Jesus was roadkill, and we ran over him. And that's what he looked like in that picture, you know. And yet that roadkill got up and said, I did that for you, the ones who ran over me. See? So there's a spirit behind this, and if we miss that spirit, guess what? I'm going to say it like this. I question if our faith is full. I didn't say that we're not saved. And in none of this am I inferring salvation per se, but recognizing God through Christ crucified. Therefore, knowing him truly. That's what I'm talking about. And if we don't know that, but we know we're saved, I don't know if I want to hang out with y'all in heaven. I'm joking. But I'm just saying there's this lack of wanting to pursue him. There's this lack of wanting to lay hold of him. All I want to be happy with is to know I'm saved and that basically I'm all right when it comes to I'm not going to go to hell or whatever else. But, you know, to put any effort towards really discovering you, you know, I've got my life down here. And my life is really important to me, and it's, you know, and God wants me to be faithful to my job, and okay, you know, I'm not refuting any of that. I'm questioning your heart for Jesus, especially during this season when the Lord himself has set in motion these things. And if he has done that, then we fail of the grace of God when it is offered to us at this season to be able to pursue with all of our heart, and gives us the time and the place and the, you know, these sort of things. So I wrote, the cross bought and brought the benefits, but through a certain spirit in which Jesus gave himself. It was that certain spirit that he gave himself that made it different from any other giving of themselves. So anybody will give themselves. I mean, you know, somebody will throw themselves in front of a car to save a child or save their child. You know, perhaps for a good man, one would even dare to die. But God, you see, that was the contrast. And the Lord slammed into us in chapter 5 when we were studying chapter 5 with that. He hit us hard with that. And I'm going to tell you this right now. I'm just going to say this. You know, every class that we have here can just be another class. It would just sound like another class. Or it can be spirit-breathed, depending on your state. Oh, I've heard that before, you know. Well, have you heard it yet? By the Spirit of God. That's the real question. And if we can say, I heard that before, then we need to say, but I need to hear it either again, or I need to hear it greater. because I need to be with the Lord in the Spirit in this season and know my Jesus and make it about Him and not about myself. See? But through a certain spirit in which Jesus gave Himself. This means that our faith needs to be not just in the work. I believe He did something 2,000 years ago. Let's see. I was told that He died on a cross, and somehow that magically has saved me, and I believe it. You know, I don't understand it, but I believe it. And I got news for you. Faith, and you know, we're talking about faith. Faith is not blind faith. Faith is actually seeing. But it's seeing things that are not seen. It is seeing the unseen things of the Lord. And then I put, this means that our faith needs to be not just in the work, but in the spirit of the one who gave. And then I wrote, do we believe in that? And the word that, all capitals and three question marks behind it. Because this is what we're getting into right now. We need to have faith in the spirit of the one who gave Himself. The cross method is what we're just using a term for a period of time here now to help us get into that. All right, still in chapter 11, flip over, Romans 11, look at verse 20. Verse 20, well, because of unbelief they were broken off, and thou standest by faith. Be not high-minded, but fear. Folks, the faith is that Jesus died so that we would have life. The faith then moves into, we're going to live by this. So that we're going to die, Galatians 2:20 is a perfect example of that. We're going to die that Christ may live, and we're going to give ourselves so that others may live. Okay, first two commandments, love the Lord thy God with all your heart, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. The fulfillment of that, folks, is not some weird whatever, wherever we put that. That is, I have received the spirit of the one who gave Himself, or I have seen and embraced the cross method of God, which is by His spirit and by His nature, and I am crucified with Christ, and I embrace that so that Christ may live in me. And that's the first commandment, love the Lord thy God with all of it, because all of it's spent into death. And the second one is, that you begin to live, that just live by faith, and you begin to live that way towards other people, and that's the fulfillment of the second commandment. And all the commandments are fulfilled in this. Okay, so if we don't understand those first two, we just say, I love God because I got saved and I have a love in my heart, and Jesus is really special to me, and especially on Sunday, and Easter's really special too, and you know, da da da, and you know, so I just, and have no sense of what we've been brought into by being brought into in Christ. No sense at all of who we now are. I'm a new creation. What's new about you? Well, I quit smoking. Okay, cool. Is that it? I quit stealing erasers from the school or something. I don't know. You know, some weird, dumb things, you know, that we pile up, and even if we have a nice pile, It misses the Lord. It misses the mark, therefore. It misses the Lord, you know. All right, so much of the early stages of faith is connected to the concept of grace, but in most people's mind, not as it is seen in light of God's nature. So that's what we've been saying here this evening. Rather, to them, grace is simply are seen as acts of a benevolent God. How can I take a sledgehammer and actually break through that these are not just acts of a benevolent God? Not in the sense that we think. We just think, well, He's God, so He's really nice, and we're not, and we need Him. But it's more than that. He's not just really nice and being benevolent to us when we deserve the worst. He is self-giving, God died. God was crucified for me. You know, oh, Jesus died for me. We use that so flippantly. Well, Jesus died, you know, Jesus died for me, you know. And here's why we use it so flippantly. But he rose again. You know, it's like 3 days. It's not that big a deal. You know, it's just 3 days. Come on, you know. But we don't see that he bore all of that for us so that we could be free. And he selflessly did that knowing that he would take the worst and we would get the best. Okay. As we open our hearts to God, faith is then released for new birth, which is a faith that brings believers through the cross and into oneness with the crucified. Okay. Well, that's not news to us. You know, we're born in Adam. Then there was the cross. And then we were raised in Christ. Okay? Very common little chart we use around here all the time. Jesus didn't do a chart. He didn't do it. There was an actual cross where he gave himself completely and willingly and not for himself, but for others. And the only hope that he'd ever get anything back personally out of it is if we took on his same spirit and then we died that he may live. Amen. That's it. Think of it. You know, we say, well, you know, all over the world on Sunday, people raise their hands. Yeah, that's it? Okay. Is that it then? No, and we say stuff like, thank you, Jesus. You know, he ought to be happy with that. Or we say, you know, but we say we worship him. But again, we go back to that thing. Are we worshiping the Lamb on the throne while violating him in the way we basically live selfishly and get upset with everybody else around us and won't lay down our lives because we have no concept. Real, you can't, I mean, let's just hope you have no concept of the Lamb on the throne. Let's hope you don't understand it and just go, you know what? I don't care. I don't care what you were like. I mean, I appreciate everything you did. Let's just hope that we don't know him. And at the cross, we didn't. We didn't know what we did. We didn't know what he did. You know, disciples all ran away and said, well, this is our Jesus. What happened? You know, we hoped that everything would have worked out, and this is a failure. See, and we hate failure, and we hate weakness. We hate being seen in a bad light, and we hate the cross. Do you understand? We hate the Lamb nature. We have to, you know, you're never going to repent unless you see it as sin. You know, you're never going to be sorry. You're never going to realize the depth of the wound to him, which all those wounds were ours. But you're never going to grasp that on any kind of a real basis. I'll just keep it all theological. I'll just keep it all spiritual. It doesn't really matter. I don't understand, and I'm ignorant of this, and I'm, you know, the main thing is I just love Jesus, and I know that if I just love Jesus, everything's going to be all right. Human love is not going to hack it. You're supposed to be loving him to death. You know what I mean? Jesus, I love you to death, to my death, not this time yours, you know. But that's, see, anybody can say, well, I love you, Jesus, for the death you died for me. Well, that's because you got everything out of it. That's not hard. Try going and try doing what Paul did. Try looking deep within that lamb. Try looking deep within there and going, you know, it's beautiful when it works my way. But I can't give it back. I'm not going to give it back. I'm not gonna, this is not gonna be reciprocal. You know, this is this circle we always draw of the eternalness of Christ. And of course, we always put little us's in here, you know, and you know, we're a bunch of pox on the body of Christ there. But rather, the reality is we're just in him. We're found in him, but we're not known in him. We're only known by him because we're in him. Christ is your life. You know, all of the things that are true of him now are true of you. Well, how many of us can draw this on the board and say, everything that's true of him is true of me? And I'm going to walk by the faith of that. Well, okay, let's pick a few out. Let's see everything that's true of him. He is totally selfless, and he'll die any chance he gets. He looks for it, and he wants to lose so that you'll look better. How about that? You going to start working on that? Rich young ruler. Well, dude, I don't want to give up rich, and I don't want to give up ruler, and you know, I'm still young. I got time to live. Anybody ever witness to somebody and they say, well, I'm not ready to make a decision yet. You know, well, you know, if you were like 86 lying on your deathbed, would you be ready right now? Say, I'm a bad witnesser because I do this stuff, you know. You know, why are you not ready? I mean, if you were literally knew that you're going to die within the next hour, there, you know, would you be ready yet? Or are you going, I'm really not ready yet? I said, you know, I remember one guy, I said, if there's a big, great big hole and fire was coming up and it was drop you into hell and demons were dragging you, kicking and screaming closer and closer to the fire, do you think you'd be ready? You know? And he said, well, you know, maybe. And I said, well, you are there. You're that close. You're that close. You could, you know, you step out in the street and a banana truck hits you and it's all over with. From bananas to hell. How about that? That, you know, does that sound right to you? You all real open for that mess? You know, I don't know what's wrong with people. All I know is that Jesus, we say this, you know, Jesus, you're worth it all. You know, I remember in my mind today, he was sharing with me, and the Holy Spirit, this word, worthy, came to my mind, and I saw us worshiping and saying, worthy. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Okay. But then over here is so here's we're all around the throne going, worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. Well, I was hoping in that picture everybody would turn and start pointing to one another, going, unworthy are you, unworthy am I, unworthy. And that there might be more worship in that, you know, when it's mixed together. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because we just go, worthy are you? Well, you know, we kind of go, you know, I'm unworthy, but I'm worshiping you, so I'm worthy. I mean, I could be at the bar drunk on my tail. So I'm worthy, but I'm not. Worthy, worthy. But if everybody just looked around and said, unworthy, 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 all of us unworthy, worthy, can I just focus back, worthy, 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 no, you, unworthy, you, we're unworthy, unworthy, now focus back, oh my God, worthy, worthy. You know, you could feel the tide rising instead of just, worthy, 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 glory, glory, you know, this half-hearted, you know, the scriptures talk about praising him with the understanding, and it talks about, you know, that sort of thing, not just, you know, worshiping him in spirit and in truth. Okay, well, and I'm sorry I hit on stuff, but, well, I couldn't be there because I had to do this or that, so I'm sorry I couldn't be there when you were going to speak to us and you were going to give the true release of your heart. I just couldn't be there. Okay, well, to worship in spirit and in truth is to come in that same spirit and say, like to an altar, like we're, you know, offering up ourselves that Christ may come forth. I am crucified with Christ, that the sweet savor of Christ may come forth. So I come, I give up all. Well, you know, most of us, when we say we give up all, we pretty much talk about the first 3 months of salvation. You know, or, I mean, some of us make it to a year where we're still throwing stuff out. But I mean, you know, I gave it all up, you know, just like Jonah in the boat. You know, throwing everything overboard. Well, this is probably wrong. Let's throw this overboard. I bet this is causing the problem. You know, help me with this. Storm still going. Oh, well, let's see. Let's look around. Something else. I know there's probably some voodoo on board here somewhere. No, it's you, idiot. You're worse than voodoo. You're running from the Lamb. Well, if I go witness to them, they'll kill me.
That's right.
Well, don't worry about it. I got something that'll do that before you get there. You know, I was talking with somebody the other day who said, well, you know, some people can go a little overboard on, you know, a little overboard on seeking the Lord during this time period. And I thought, well, I think Jonah went overboard. I said, and even overboard wasn't enough for him.
Right.
So that they said, he's overboard. And they go, oh my God, this guy's giving himself into the belly of a whale. He's going deeper down. Folks, it was when he went overboard that started the process, not in the boat safe, right? Safety for me. It was when he went overboard that started, but it wasn't it, was it? It was when he went into the belly of the whale, his whole tone changed. It was the most beautiful prayer that he cried out from the belly of the whale, and it was a cross prayer. It was, you know. So overboard for him meant ultimately the cross. And that's what Jesus described not going overboard, but being swallowed by a whale. Do y'all remember that? That's what Jesus described as the cross. Jesus said, even as Jonah, 3 days and three nights. So he's saying there in that part, the overboard part is just trying to get you to a place. Can I get an amen?
Yes.
You know? But if you're not overboard, if you're clinging to the edge going, oh my God, I'm going through the cross, I'm seasick. Ugh. God's going, that is not the cross. That's you wouldn't even be on this boat throwing up if you hadn't been running from me. I don't run from you, I'm your prophet. My name's Jonah. That means dove. I'm like the Holy Spirit. I'm sweet. No, you're not. You need to go down, buddy. You're going down. But you know, Jonah was the one who said to them, throw me overboard. He said, you know, he asked. In other words, he's going, I'm ready to go overboard for Jesus. I'm ready. And they did him a favor, didn't they?
Yes.
They didn't even want to do it. But you see, I think maybe when he finally got to that spirit, then it brought him right into the presence of the cross. And it opened him up to stuff that you don't see in the safety of your little boat. You know? Praise God. I have no clue where I am in my notes. But as we begin to grow in the knowledge of the Lord, meaning as we begin to know the Lord, not grow in the depth of the stinking deep stuff that Brother Randy preaches. But as we begin to grow in the knowledge of the Lord, we apprehend that life out of death is something more to God than we first imagined. Life out of death is, or this cross method, it's more something to God than what we first imagined. The subject of faith then begins to be seen from God's perspective and not just in light of our salvation from punishment and hell. Faith. Okay. Now let's just assume that Galatians 2:20 is really talking about Jesus, functioning, coming to the earth, literally coming to the earth, knowing and then becoming a man, and then going to a cross and knowing that God is going to be rejected in the most horrible way possible, but he's going to give himself to it. He's going to do it because he knows, or he believes, or he comprehends this nature that he has, that if I give myself in this spirit, then something will come out of it for them. Okay, let's just assume that he has a faith, just for our sharing here, that he has a faith in life out of death. Then the faith is something greater to God than we can imagine. Eye hath not seen, ear hath not heard. We hadn't even come into the heart of man. This is outside of us. This is him. This is his nature. This is his faith. This is his nature. Okay? But then, I read the sentence just a second ago, that faith then begins to be seen from God's perspective and not the perspective of, I'm getting out of hell. Or punishment. It's a world of difference. My God, people, it's the difference between I'm living down here and I'm fighting with sin and I'm fighting with the devil and I'm trying to live for God and thank God I got forgiveness and Jesus comes in here and he forgives me and I get to go back to the way I was before and find new problems that come up because of my self-centered, selfish, prideful, yucky me. Okay, now let's translate us above. We're translated above. And all of a sudden, we see the beginning from the end. We see Alpha and Omega. We see, and this is what happened to John, see. Once he got out of the earth, you know, I'm in exile, I'm on an island, I can't get away, there's sharks. I don't know what all you know, I sound serious. He was, hey, there's sharks, I can't. Anyway, there is, you know, all of a sudden he's caught up, and now the first thing he sees is Jesus, but he goes, you are Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I thought you were just a Jewish Messiah. I thought you were a local Messiah. My God, you're greater than even, you're not just the Savior of the world. You're the Alpha and Omega. You're the first, you're the beginning and the end. You're the length and the breadth and the height and the depth. And you are without end, you without beginning and without end. You are Melchizedek. You are the fulfillment of all things. But I need to get back down because they're going to be serving something good on the prison thing tonight. You know, I need to get back to the aisle because that's really where I live. This was just a revelation. This was a revelation. And I'm going to take it back with me, okay, Jesus, okay, Alpha and Omega. Yeah, I mean, it's just, thank you for that laugh, because it's just laughable if you see it and you say that. But if you see him and you see him outside, your faith will be outside of the confines, and all of a sudden, If it is him that you've seen, this lamb, this spirit, this selflessness, this cross method as demonstrated through his nature, or this nature demonstrating what we would call a cross method so that we can identify what it is, then you would go, you know, I have to live by this. I mean, I want to live by this. You won't go, you know, let me just slip back down onto the aisle for a while, and, you know, even though it's an exile and even though I'm a prisoner, you know, they did give me a nice new mattress, and I'd really hate to, you know, see, I mean, I'm telling you, our minds are evil. They are evil. You say, why? Because it didn't sound like John was conceiving some horrible thing. I'm going to go back, you know, Lord, that's great seeing you as Alpha and Omega, but I need to get back to the aisle because I planned this week to do a suicide bombing and kill a bunch of people. And then you go, your mind is evil. No, your mind, my mind is evil because we cannot make him any greater than some little concept, because that's all he is to us right now. And we can't, you know, so we do our best, we throw as much worship and honor toward him and everything, but when we go out, our lives are on cruise control, and it's our life, and it will do what our life does. It'll be selfish, it'll be self-important, it'll get upset if somebody blames you for something you didn't do, and you'll have to justify. You gotta explain yourself. You got to. You must. But the lamb doesn't. You go, Jesus, that's really dumb. If you'd have just explained yourself, maybe they wouldn't have killed you. He's going, I came here to die. This is what I do. That's what John came away with.
Praise God.
This is what I do too. I'm one with you. See, we are, oh, I'm one with Jesus, meaning I get the benefits. Or I'm one with you, because if this is the way you're going to be, Jesus, I'm going to be with you. What do you think of that? And Jesus just goes, I think it's the answer of the ages. I think it's the most eternal thing I ever heard out of your mouth. You know? And he goes, so let me start sending the Holy Spirit stronger, and let's keep moving. Joseph.
So when you were talking about the people just worshiping the Lord, you know, saying worthy, and that, you know, as we're saying, we're unworthy, and they said the tide is rising, and just, you know, got a picture of, you know, all of us just standing out in the ocean during the low tide, just saying worthy, worthy, worthy is the Lord, you know, worthy are you. And then the tide starts coming in and rising, and, you know, there's the temptation to look back and start looking at the tide rising, and, well, is anyone else starting to draw back and, you know, get to higher ground? But, you know, I just want to stand my ground with the Lord and say, worthy, worthy, worthy. Let these waves and billows come over me like Jonah was saying.
That's right.
Let your billows and waves,
that's
let
the way.
Come over, let them overtake me.
Right.
Let the sea, you are worthy. You
that's
are worthy.
Right. That's
I
right.
I don't want to get on higher ground. I don't want to live.
Amen.
I want you to live, Lord.
Amen. Well, I really saw that thing with Jonah as water baptism, just like what you described. It's a baptism into his death. And what you just described is that tide come in, and man, it'll just take you out to sea with it when it starts going out, in and out and stuff. I mean, I remember when I was in my wild child days, and a bunch of us went down to Galveston to be surfing in the Gulf, and so we surfed and surfed. We surfed till late, and then we didn't have any money to go get a hotel or stuff, so we parked on the beach. And we got surfboards on the top and everything, and all of a sudden we wake up, and the surf was coming in, and it was already around the car, and to get a car out of sinking sand is like crazy. And there was a bunch of it, and we're just going, oh my God, it pushed through there. We're getting the surfboards and sticking them under, and going, oh my God, we can't do this. We'll never get back, you know. I mean, and, oh God, we, you know. Well, that's baptism right there. You're just you're sunk and you're brought under and you're kept under and you're brought into death. The whale is the true death. It represents the cross, and it's not just getting wet. So you've been going overboard, you're just getting wet. That's water baptism. Being swallowed by a whale, that's baptism into Christ's death. Scott? Right.
And he was there freely giving his life.
Right.
And, you know, it just hit me that, you know, why would he fight for survival if he came with his life?
Well, and that's the thing. And here's the deal. Remember, we said this a couple of classes back, too, and that is we say, why would Jesus fight for his life if he came to lay his life down? But we see that as a plan. We see that God got together and said, let's do a plan, and let's have one big time where God gives himself, you know, and that'll be our plan, and then it'll be over with, okay, and then everybody will be free and stuff. But that is not the deal. It wasn't a plan. It was their nature, the determinant counsel of God's being, not just a plan. This is going to be, and let's call it the plan of salvation. It'll be cool. You know, we'll make them, then we'll turn the devil loose on them, then we'll defeat the devil, and then they'll love us. You know, ridiculous people. But he goes, well, you know, and I think, personally think Adam and Eve had free will in the garden, and I think they could have chosen the tree of life. I mean, you know, if you have free will, I think you could have. And they didn't have a fallen nature because they hadn't fallen yet. So what if God said, well, you know, what if the Holy Spirit said, well, what do we do if they, you know, go ahead and eat that tree and, you know, and fall into sin? You know, or what do we do if they don't? I think the cross, if not the cross, but the crucified nature is who they are. And they're going to give their self one way or the other. And I say they, one God, but Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. All right, so at first glance, we may simply see the concept of life out of death as the cross is the answer. Oh, the cross is the answer. No. The cross is two pieces of wood. The crucified him, capital, the crucified is the answer. So we go, oh, the cross is the answer. Thank God there was wood. You know, thank God there was wood, and thank God Jesus decided to give up his ministry, though it was big for him to do that, you know, and go die, but he did it because he's a sweetheart, you know. No, this isn't just the cross is the, oh, the cross is the answer, the cross is the, no, you laying down your life, that's the answer. Now let the cross work in you, let Christ crucified live in you. And say, well, you know, I was selfish and so I did this and I hurt a lot of people and I'm, you know, I'm cruel to the bone, but the cross is the answer. It will cover me. In my predicament. And the Holy Spirit would say, I'm not down here just, you know, Jesus already died and covered your sins, but I'm down here. God is still with you in the form of me, the Holy Spirit, and it's my job to teach you the Christ that you now live in. And that, all this mess you're trying to get me to clean up, the Holy Spirit's still talking. I wouldn't even have to do if you hadn't had the spirit of the one that you claim to, if you had the spirit of the one that you're one with. But you don't, you know. Your oneness is theological. It is not the one, you know. So at first glance, we simply see the concept of life out of death as the cross is the answer. But eventually we begin to see that God's cross method is the answer. It is for us to lay down our lives. This cross method is the answer. With time, our eyes slowly begin to be opened to see that out of all, here, listen to this, with time, our eyes slowly begin to see that out of all the methods God could have chosen to bring about redemption and life, he chose death. The death of God. The death of God. That's what he chose. Okay. All right. Some of us here are creative, so we could think of a whole lot of ways to save the universe if it fell into sin, and we could come up, hey, let's do this, or let's do that, or whatever. But God is way, way, way more creative than any of us. Look at all the different fish, insects, the universe, the different ways of breathing or eating or seeing. Oh, my God, he's so creative. I'm pretty sure he could have thought of a better plan. No, he couldn't. Because this was God. This is the way of God. The cross method is the way of his nature. And he's not going to come up with something that's not him and just do something that's he does. With God, what he says is him. With God, what he does, it's him. He doesn't just go, you know, he doesn't do what we do. And that's hard for us to comprehend, but it's still the truth. It's still the truth. And so, you know, he's not trying to be imaginative. You say, well, but, you know, all that stuff he made, creative, well, that wasn't really him. Well, let's see, a seed falling into the ground and die. And we can just go on and on and on, everything from the astral to the, you know, it is all based on that heart and that spirit. And we saw some of that in the physics class that we discussed. Not just stuff God does, but who he is. So he chose death, the death of God. And with that, as our eyes are slowly open to that, something is added to our faith. We're not just believing in that there's a God, or that he came down and had a plan and died and that's it. And there's no more. Now it's just happy, happy, happy. You know, that's not the plan. There is no plan. There's only God. And that's why, in the beginning, God, you know. And when it's all wrapped up, Jesus, everything's delivered to Jesus. He delivers it up to the Father so that God may be all in all. It all starts there, and it's all going to end there. And it's all that reality that is unending and not based on my little penny-any petty likes and dislikes in this world. I can't even imagine what we look like to the Godhead. I mean, I just can't even imagine it. It just must be horrendous. But to us, we call it, well, we're just living. I'm just living my life. Oh, excuse me. So something is added to our faith. Faith no longer merely embraces certain doctrines as its belief system, but faith lays hold of the fact that death is God's chosen method for freedom from sin, law, the world, etc., 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 etc. It's his. He chose this way because, again, it's the way he is. But he chose this. This is the, we do, we're going to do it this way. There's no argument. Okay, well, with us, we have to get into certain situations. We have to get into certain situations and then decide if we're going to be like one with the Lamb. It's like we, and then we're out of it after that situation's gone and we're back to who we are. But at least I'm looking for opportunities for the Lamb. But folks, the amount of opportunities we're looking for is like maybe one every 2 weeks or something. I don't know what we're looking for, but it ain't much compared to moment by moment. Even thought, you know, your thought life, captivating, bringing into captivity every thought, you know, to the obedience of Christ crucified. As we have stated in the past, this cross method is actually the nature of the God we serve and love. It is the nature of the God we claim to serve and love. However, we are using the term cross method to help open us up to a mode of operation that we are to initially embrace conceptually. We need to embrace the cross method conceptually first. If you can't conceptualize it, you don't even know what to believe, much less have faith. So we're using the term cross method to help open us up to a mode of operation that we are to initially embrace conceptually, but eventually become the means by which we proceed as Christians. And if that's our means of how we proceed, then I'll call it Christian. You see what I'm saying? I won't react, and I'll go ahead and say, yeah, okay. Because that's what I think Christians are supposed to be. Christians. You know? The concept must be owned. We have to own it. The concept must be owned by us before we will ever submit to it as our mode of lifestyle. Okay, so you have to conceptualize it. This is going to be a big deal in the next couple of classes, but it has to be conceptual, at least in your mind, so that you can see what it is that started everything and that ended everything. And, you know, and the starting and the end, the start was just God, in the beginning God. The end is the cross. That's the end of us in our old nature. That's the end of us as the old creatures. That's the end. He's not looking for the rapture or the end time stuff that we think he's looking for to be the end. Well, when is the end going to come? For you, it already came. Check it out, Romans 6. But see, that can't be a doctrine. So to conceptualize it is to see that it is the beginning and the end. It is God in the manner that he gives himself or the nature which he has, and it is the cross that manifested it to mankind in its severest mode, and that God was willing to go to the utter lengths, not just to save us, but to reveal himself to us at the cross.
Yes.
And to bring an end to the old creation, and to bring a new beginning, a new beginning. See, well, I was talking about, I want to get a new beginning, which means we wipe the slate clean or something, but it's still the same old chalkboard, right? It's always faithful, the same old chalkboard. But the true new beginning, there has to be an end. And that end takes place at the cross. Then the new beginning is who? It's Jesus. But it's Christ crucified now in us, and we'll explain that more. Okay, let me make sure. Okay. Yeah, that's it. The concept must be owned by us before we will ever submit to it as our mode of lifestyle. And I know that's probably not a good grammar or English, but it explains that there's a mode in which our lifestyle should form. Okay, we'll take a break.